My name is Lucas Jellema. I'm from the Netherlands, and I'm here on my day off. In the Netherlands, we have a national holiday to celebrate the move to the cloud. We call it Ascension Day. It's actually a day off in the Netherlands, but it has nothing to do with that cloud. I was listening to the speaker at the end of the keynote about being mindful, and I'm trying to be in this moment and to be mindful of what we're doing. And sometimes the border between what I call work and what's hobby is very hard to determine, and my family doesn't really understand that as they're having this day off. But also when they see me working at home, especially when I was working the last few weeks on the demos for this session, and it's all fun and games, and it has serious overtones and undertones, and it is real, but it's also fun. So I hope to convey some of that fun and some of the actual meaning that fun could have for your jobs and your application architects, because in the end, that's what it's about. I've been active in IT for about 25 years, for the last 17 years using Java and a bunch of other technologies. Before, it was mainly focused on Oracle database, or the traditional Oracle technology, but it has been expanding quite a bit. Oracle has, I have, my company has. There won't be a lot of Oracle in this talk today. We're talking about user interfaces, but it's not only about user interfaces. That's just one way of presenting things and the nicest way of presenting things. But the notion of activeness, if you like, is something that applies to more than just the user interface. It applies to the API, it applies to other channels, and we'll discuss those later on. But let's say we have a nice user interface and we want our end users to make use of that user interface, and they want to see the latest information, of course, always the latest and greatest. And we, of course, want to convey that information, but it may be the case that they don't trust us to always present the latest information. They will start pressing the F5 button. You as users probably have done that, and you as developers have seen your users do that, and you may have cursed at them for that. And if they still don't trust what's happening, they will go for bigger and stronger means, and they will use the control F5. And it's even worse. Now, it's not better in terms of it gets them the information any faster. Usually it won't, or quite the opposite. It will mean that your backend is suffering quite a lot. What does it mean when there is an F5? Well, there is some piece of middleware that gets requested stuff. And when it's a control F5, it gets requested even more stuff. And it's one thing that this piece of middleware has to do some work. That's what it's there for, even though it shouldn't be doing redundant work. But it's not just the middleware, it's also all the backend systems that's hitting. So every F5 is likely to put pressure on the underlying systems as well. And more F5s means more load on the underlying system, probably degrading the performance of the whole user experience for all users. So it's not fixing anything, it's actually deteriorating things. So what can we do to help our users get the user experience they want to have, to provide them with the latest information, and hopefully also to make them trust us so they don't hit that F5 key all the time? That's, in a nutshell, what this talk is about, and I will be using some underlying technologies and some streaming analysis as well. So it's about fast data that's streaming in all the time, things that are happening all the time, and the active UI that we want to base on that. So what we need to do is be able to handle the data influx, the event influx, and the terms data and event are getting mixed up, as we saw in the serverless presentation as part of the keynote. We want to analyze whatever's streaming in real time. We want to filter, we want to aggregate, we want to find things that are missing. We want maybe to do running and time windowed calculations. And when we have these findings, we want to notify the end users. And we want to notify them without them having to press any buttons at all. Please don't press any buttons. You will see instant update notifications in your UI, also in your enterprise applications and your web shop, not just in the apps that you run on your smartphone, because that's where we can do it, or where users are used to it. And what we need to have is an architecture with decoupled components. It's, of course, something that's, well, doesn't really need saying anymore. We need decoupling. And we may be using microservices. We won't necessarily go into microservices today, but we need decoupling. because we may have different speeds of processing, we may have different number of instances of all components. Some components may not be available all the time. So they should be work pretty much isolated, but of course still data needs to flow from one component to another. Events need to be handed over to be able for processing and presenting. So you could say what we're talking about is a user interface that's talking to some sort of middleware where APIs are presented that are running against backend systems, and that is what's happening, and we are pushing information from the middleware to the user interface. There is more channels involved. There's also mobile applications that we may want to send the results of our streaming analysis of this live data to. And chatbots may probably have a similar thing. Do we want to ask Siri all the time for, well, maybe for the time, but for things that may have happened in the real world? Or should we be able to ask Siri, tell us whenever it has happened, and we'll sit back and relax and we won't ask you again? Siri would like that. And there are microservices that also needs to be notified of our results of our streaming analysis of these events that are flying in. And they need to be notified live. And we don't want them to exercise their F5 right. We don't want all those microservices to ask us all the time for the latest and greatest information. Please, we'll make it available to you. Don't call us, we'll call you. So we're using a case here, but again, the case is just a stand-in for a much wider range of situations. And the case at hand is Twitter. Because it's so easy and because you can help me out. And then you can see yourself on the screen. So we'll take Twitter as a starting point. These are the events that we're going to analyze and we're going to present in the user interface. And we'll take these tweets and we'll show just the tweets, the selected tweets that you can also look up in the Twitter UI. We will show them in our own UI. And then we will allow the users of our user interface, and I'm a user, but you could be users as well, because I will make the URL available in just a moment. We will allow all users to like tweets so they can start interacting. And each tweet they like, that also results in an event. And this event is shared across all users, so all users know which tweets have been liked. And then we'll do our streaming analysis. We'll do live aggregations of the number of tweets per category. And we are filtering tweets by three categories, the DevOps UK, Java, and Oracle Code. Any tweet with either of those tags will be filtered into our system and then will be aggregated on the fly. That's a bit of streaming analysis, a very simple bit of streaming analysis, but it represents a wider range of challenges. And then we'll also look at what's the current, over the last 30 seconds, top three of best liked tweets per category. So it's like doing select statements against the relational database, which has a static data set. We are doing it now live against events as they are happening. And then we have to specify over which time period are you doing the aggregation. Well, let's say 30 seconds. So what are the best liked tweets over the last 30 seconds? And Twitter is just an example, and maybe not even quite sure it's not the best example or the most the example with the most business value. Here are some other sources of events or examples of events that we could be receiving, analyzing, and processing in real time, and providing our end users with updates about. All the code is available in GitHub. And I will make sure that I tweet with this tag the URL to the code. Or you can just take a picture of the slide, or you will get the slide afterwards. Anyways, all the code I will be showing is there. If you want to access the demo, you can go to this URL. Bit.ly, Active UI DevOps UK. If you go there, you will see the same thing that I will be showing on the big screen, and at least some of you hopefully will help me like some tweets. I can do it, but it's even nicer, of course, if you do it as well. This connects via ngRok to the application that's running locally on my laptop. If you don't know ngRok, take a look. It's it's great for exposing anything running on your laptop to a wider audience without you having to take it into the cloud, which is probably a better solution, but sometimes this is the easier way. And Grok. So just before I'm going to tell you a lot of things you already know, by show of hands, who's aware of, no? Who knows what Apache Kafka can do for you? Okay, it seems to be about half of you. And who's actively using Apache Kafka in their daily work? That's a few, 10-15%. Okay. So I'm sort of giving away the solution to part of the problem. That's going to be Apache Kafka, but it was in the title of the session, so it's not such a big spoiler. We're talking about events, and events come from somewhere. They come from producers. And in general, when we're talking about events, and we talk about events all the time, when we talk about events, the producers should produce, publish their events, leave it somewhere, and then be done with it. That's the end of their responsibility. They shouldn't need to know where the event is going to, if it's going anywhere at all, for that matter. So we need an event handling framework, the big blue arrow in the middle, that takes on the events, takes off the responsibility from the producer, and does something to the event. Well, first of all, it should be able to handle the events in a scalable manner, in a robust manner. It shouldn't lose any event. It should make all the events available to anyone who's interested. And ideally, it should hang on to those events for interested parties that are late, that are currently unavailable, or decide to show their interest only later on. And Confluent, the organization behind Apache Kafka, is definitely stimulating all of us to consider Kafka an infinite database of events. Don't throw away any event, just keep it. We are scalable as hell, so you might as well keep all the events. You never know what good it is. And of course, we would like this mechanism, this event handling mechanism, which is Kafka, to be containerized, to be cloud-enabled, etc. And then we have our consumers. Those are all the interested parties, and they specify their interest in a certain category of events, topics. They are called the categories of events, topics in Kafka. Very similar to JMS, but there are many things that are not so similar between Kafka and JMS, so don't take that analogy too closely. The consumers get their events, but they don't need to consume events at the same rate as they are being produced. That's part of the decoupling. They don't even need to consume the events at almost the same time as they are being produced. Could be much later, could not be sooner for obvious reasons. Many consumers could consume the same event or from the same event topic because they are consuming those events for different purposes. That's fine. And if there are too many events for any consumer to process by their own, they can set up a consumer group and work in parallel. A couple of things about Apache Kafka. It started live at LinkedIn, where they know a bit about scale. In 2011 and 12, it was open sourced under the Apache Kafka, under the Apache umbrella called Apache Kafka. The 1.0 release finally went live last December. But before that, Kafka has been used or has been in use at many organizations. It started out at the larger organizations, now being used at smaller organizations. Many organizations are considering it. It's everywhere, and I'm not sure where it's going. It seems to be like one of those big things that in the end everyone will have. Client libraries available in almost any technology. So in that sense, Kafka is truly cross-technology. Kafka itself, but especially the ecosystem around Kafka. And the Kafka project itself also includes Connect, which is a large collection of connectors to both sources and sinks of events. So you can get events from, for example, Twitter. There's a connector. I didn't use it. I used some of my own code, but I could have used an adapter. And there are many more for databases and for other sources and targets. We'll talk about streams. That's part of Apache Kafka. And then there's KSQL. And that's one of the maybe surprises or the more exotic things of today. KSQL is not part of Apache Kafka, but it is part of the open source Confluent platform. So it is available to anyone who wants to use it. And here's a brief graphical overview of the evolution of Kafka in the last few years. Over here, and this is March 2018, I think it's March, but it could even be April, at least it's very recent, we saw the release of the 4.1 version of the Confluent platform, including the general availability of KSQL, and more about KSQL in a moment. Some terminology, well, we don't need all that much for today, there are topics. That's basically the only thing you need to know for today. Partitions have to do with scaling and distribution, and we won't go there for now. We'll just publish events to topics and have consumers reading them from topics. We will have many topics, by the way. We'll start with just one, a tweets topic, but we will have many. And I'll talk about that later as well. And when we start to scale things up, then you could draw a picture like this. And at some point, it can get a little bit complex. And to manage a Kafka cluster is not all that easy. It is reliable. It is distributed. It's not easy necessarily to manage it. And there are some organizations who offer managed Kafka environments. And those might be worth to take a look at. So in this case, the case at hand, we have our tweets and we want to present the tweets in the user interface. And our first step will be to have the tweets, take them off from Twitter, do the first filtering, so only the three tags that I mentioned, and put those tweets on a Kafka topic. So they're ours. And if Twitter goes down, we still have all the tweets we need, or at least the ones that have been published so far. And we could do that using Kafka Connect for Twitter. We could do it using IFTTT. You can set up a recipe there and have a tweet event turned into a REST API call and then put it through a Node application, for example, on your Kafka topic. In this case, I created my own Node application that uses the Node for Twitter library to connect to Twitter, get the tweets from there, and store them onto the tweets topic. The specific implementation here was done using the Oracle Cloud. There's the one mention of Oracle in the session, the Oracle Cloud, where I have an Oracle application container service, where I put my Node application and it just runs it, and where I have a managed Kafka environment. It's called Event Hub, and that's where I've just created a topic. So here's the user interface in the cloud environment for creating the topic. And I've indicated that I want the tweets to be retained on the topic for 168 hours. So not indefinitely, but what's that? 7 days. Could have done longer. This is all I need. And here's the application container cloud. I take my Node application, I put it in a zip file containing all its libraries, I upload a zip file, and the application is running in the cloud. And some of the code inside the application, and all the code is available, so I'm not going to go through each detail, we don't really have the time. Basically, a connect to a Kafka host, in this case it's a local host. I specify the topic I'm interested in. I specify whether I want to get all the events from the topic from the beginning of time, that's earliest. I came to regret that session, by the way, setting, so I've changed this to latest, which means starting now and until into the future. And I have registered my consumer with Kafka. The consumer, by the way, the client itself, even if it's hidden in the code, keeps track of the offset, knows how far it has read from the Kafka topic. When it goes away, it can return, it can resume reading, or revert all the way back to a different offset or the earliest offset altogether. And then finally, whenever an event arrives on message, then this function should be called, a function aptly called on message. And there's the code for the function. And in this code, it says, iterate over all subscribers. And subscribers here are Node.js functions. And invoke each subscriber function and let them know that we have received a message with a certain value. And in this particular case, I have subscribed a tweet listener, and the tweet listener is my Node application that presents the user interface to the web browsers. And when it receives a message, it will parse the message, it will look up. It will store the tweet in its local cache, and it will then update the SSE clients. And that's the part that we haven't discussed yet, the SSE clients, the server sent event clients. So the flow is from Twitter to the tweets topic, and from the tweets topic to the Node application. And the Node application makes use of this standard HTML5 mechanism called server sent events to push all the events that it has received from the tweets topic to push them out to all the clients. And maybe I should now briefly show the application. And if any one of you is following along, you will see the exact same thing. Things are being tweeted. And if you now tweet anything on Twitter with the hashtag DevOxUK, then your tweet should show up here as well. And also on any other active UI. So not just on this one client. Here is the same application running in Firefox. So my local Node application has at least two and maybe more server-sent event clients, user interfaces, browsers that have all connected to my laptop that are now being sent events. So Twitter to Kafka, Kafka to Node application pushing server-sent events to all the browsers. And here's the effect. The code that you need for pushing messages from a Node application to these browser clients is very simple. Here, I have a list of all my interested clients, all my browsers that have registered themselves as listeners for the server sent events. And when there is a message, I simply loop over all the clients and tell each client, here's your message. Push the message. And Node knows how to use HTTP to send out the message to all the browsers. I will show you the client-side code in a moment. And we need one other piece in the server-side application, and that's where the browser registers. So here, at the URL path /updates, that's where the I want to register as a listener request comes in from the browser. And when that happens, we simply add the connection for that request. We add it to the list of clients. So here we collect, you want to listen as well. I will notify you as well. So that's where we build the list of all the clients that we should send the server sent events to. Now the client side code, this is very simple. By the way, the user interface looks fairly sober. It's ugly. Let's be frank, it's ugly. I didn't want to steer away or to take you away from the underlying mechanisms. So it's all bare bones HTML and JavaScript. There are, except for Bootstrap, there are no other client-side frameworks involved. So to keep it clean, the code, and because I'm lousy at user interfaces. So here's the HTML file, and it loads, and then it also loads the JavaScript library. And in the JavaScript library, the first line is create an event source, which is a server sent event source, which basically means register me, I'm the browser, register me as a listener for server sent events at this URL, /updates. Remember, previous slide, /updates, that's where the request came in at the server side. This is where the request for listening is sent from the client side. And when we then receive on this event source, when we receive a message, we get a tweet, we have to somehow write that tweet to the UI. That's the final link in the chain. So here in the end, we write HTML with the latest tweet that has come in. That's all fairly simple. So that's the flow. Next step, the likes. So in our user interface, users can, I didn't show that before, but you can click here to like the tweets. Oh, that's a good tweet. Very good, very good. That one too. And of course, other users in their own user interface can also like tweets. And here we see a list of all the recent likes. So if anyone is currently also using the application, you could like, and it would show here. There's a like. Don't know where it came from. Thank you. And if I go back here and I like Caesar, I like. Well, should have gone for the paid option. Well, anyway, when we like in the client, that like is sent to the server. And in this case, we send it back. And not just to the same client, that wouldn't make sense. Yeah, I know I liked, that's what I just did. But also to all the other clients. Now, this could be done also with server sent events, but there's another mechanism called WebSockets that's probably a little bit better here. It's bidirectional conversation between any two components that are capable of doing a WebSocket communication. So typically it's used between server and browser, but it could be between different microservices or at least the different server components as well, as long as you do HTTP and you support WebSockets. So here we use WebSockets. Code is a little bit similar to what we saw before. We define, this is server-side again, we define the WebSocket server. And when the connection has been established, so there is now a WebSocket server running, this stretch of code becomes active, and when there is a message received on the WebSocket, so we get a message on the server side from the client, we check if it's a tweet-like, and it's the only message that you have on my application, so it will always be a tweet-like. And if there is such an event, we're going to update all the WebSocket clients. So we receive the event from one client, and we push it then out to all the clients. And all we need to do is loop over the clients and send them the message and be done with it. That's all. In this case, I have embedded it in this application, but actually the WebSocket server that just receives and pushes out can be a standalone service or standalone application. It doesn't need to be the same application that renders the user interface, that renders the HTML. Client side, when the icon is clicked, the like function is invoked, that's just local JavaScript in the client, and the tweet ID is sent to it. Here's the like function that just calls the function send text, and here's the function send text, and it's no harder than WebSocket send and then the JSON content of the event. It's that simple. There we go. That's the pushing part in the client. Then the client, of course, also receives the WebSocket event. That's what's happening here. At the top, we are initializing the WebSocket. And then when there is a message on the WebSocket, we invoke the function onMessage. In the function onMessage, we get the event. And from here, it's standard again. We just get a bunch of JSON. We parse the JSON. We process it. And we update the user interface in the worst possible way imaginable. Well, at least it does the job. That's going to be a little bit more interesting. Even more interesting. Show a live tweet aggregate per tag. Count the tweets. How many DevOps UK tweets did we have over a certain period of time? And how many tags for Java and how many tags for Oracle Code? When we have the result, we can use server send events again to push it out to all the clients. One option, and that's the only option that existed a year ago or even half a year ago, is we create a streaming application with Java. And in that streaming application, we listen to the tweets topic, we receive all the events, we do the streaming aggregation, and the result of that streaming aggregation is published to another topic. And anyone who wants to do anything with the streaming result simply registers, subscribes to the other topic, to the tweet analytics topic, to the result of the streaming analysis topic. For example, the node application that then uses it from through server sent events to send it to all the clients. And you could do this using Kafka Streams. And Kafka Streams, as I said before, is part of the Kafka project. It's open source, it's free, it's just there. If you have Kafka, you have access to Kafka Streams. And Kafka Streams is a Java library that can do the streaming analysis of the events, that knows how to talk to Kafka to get the events, that knows how to talk to Kafka to publish the results, and that also, as it turns out, uses Kafka for the intermediate results. So if you have multiple steps, you do a running code, for example, then the intermediate result is also stored on Kafka topics. And that's the internals of Kafka Streams. We don't really need to know it, but it's just an indication of how much native to Kafka this Kafka Streams is, or how entwined it is. I'm not sure what's the best way of putting it. It's very much under active development. In release 0.11, which is of last November, I guess, there is support for exactly once processing. At the moment, it's only Java, but a Scala client has been promised by Confluent to be available fairly soon. And maybe I can give you an indication of what happens when you're using Kafka Streams to create such a streaming analytics application. You get the events from a topic, and then you can do a number of things. And you can also repeat each of these things. So you can filter the top. You can do an aggregation over a time window, if you like, and that can slide through time. You can join with other topics to enrich the events. You can do transformation, mapping, changing the information. And then finally, the final result can be published to another topic. And in between, Kafka Streams may create internal topics for intermediate processing. And in this case, we could have the tweet messages. We can group them by tag, by conference, by DevOps UK or Oracle Code. We can do the aggregation. We could perhaps do a join to get some additional information about the author of the tweet. We could take the number and then round it, if you like, and then finally publish. And to do that, we just add a Maven dependency to our Java application, specify where the Kafka cluster is that we want to connect to, where are the topics that we are going to read from and publish to, and then we write our code. And code could look something like this. Now, 7 months ago, I would take you through this code line by line. And I could still do so, but we don't have all that much time, and I have a better way of approaching this. So this is all valid, and you may still be using it. But wouldn't it be nice if you could do something like this? And of course, I would only ask that question if the answer is, yeah, it would not only be nice, but you can do it. So we can write a query against an event topic. And then you can write something like select, tag filter, an account from the tweets topic, from the streaming tweets that come in, and do so over a time window. And in this case, it's a time window with a size of 5 minutes, and every 30 seconds, we create a new time window with a duration of 5 minutes, and we group by the tag filter. And you can do this using KSQL. So, before I'm going to show it, maybe first explain a little bit more. What KSQL basically does is it allows you to take events that are streaming in all the time and use the SQL way of expressing queries. And it's not a SQL query, by the way. It's not relational data, but it's the SQL way of expressing queries and apply it to the stream. And in your mind, what is a continuous stream of events almost looks like a table. And you can perform things like transform, filter, join, aggregate, just the things that we are used to do in SQL, the things that we can do in Kafka Streams, but now using simple KSQL queries rather than slightly complex Java code. And the results, as I said, are published as Kafka events. And this is, for example, what then joining looks like when you try to visualize what's happening. So, there we go. So I'm now in the KSQL command line interface, and this is not the only interface there is. I will mention the other ones. And I can do list topics, and this gives me a list of all the topics on the Kafka server that I'm currently connected to. Some of these, by the way, are real Kafka topics, and some of these are more or less artificial topics that were created by KSQL as stand-in for the intermediate processing that it does in the streaming analytics. So I could take a look at my real topic, the tweets topic. And what I see now is a live publication of all the events coming in at this topic. So there's no KSQL involved, this is just a plain topic, and I'm looking at everything that's happening on that topic, just like my code could. It's like an additional consumer. This is more for development purposes and debugging purposes. It's slightly easier than maybe the Kafka console. Only thing is, I haven't found an elegant way of getting out of that mode. So there we go again, back in the KSQL command line. List topics. And I have created, and I should show you the code. I have created a table. It's over here, the table tweets. And since the table already exists, I cannot execute this code again. Sorry. Create table tweets and then a number of, I couldn't really call them columns, but it feels like they are columns, properties, attributes. And they are based on the underlying Kafka topic tweets topic, the one that I was just printing from. And I happen to know that the messages on that topic are all in JSON format. Well, I just don't know. I also just could see it. And I indicate what is the key. And by turning this into a table, or at least something that I consider a table, I can start writing my queries against the table. Select star from tweets. From. Can I borrow someone's fingers? So now whenever something happens on the tweets topic, it also happens, or at least it gets shown at the tweets table. And it would be unfortunate if no tweets are coming in, because then sort of this part, there we go. So this is just the first step. Second step, of course, is that I can start applying other parts of SQL-like logic, and in this case, KSQL, where tag filter equals DevOps UK. And I won't get all these uninteresting tweets, but only the ones that are actually about DevOps UK. What you should what should stand out here, what should strike you, or at least in comparison with regular SQL, when you do SQL against the table, you expect to get a result, and then the query is done. You have your result, it's done. And maybe there will be additional updates and inserts into that table, but it doesn't change the result of your query. This is different. I have started the query, and I continue to talk, and the results keep coming in. It's streaming data set that we are applying the query against. It's a continuous query. There used to be event processors that had a language called CQL, Continuous Query Language. KSQL is a continuous query language. So you start your query, and until you stop the query, it will continue to try to get results for you. Events continue to be published, and the query continues to try to get those events and to find anything in those events that is worth reporting. So here we go, the query continues. Here are some other examples, and here's what happens when I start the tweet count query. It's a count of the tweets per tag filter. There's one for DevOps UK, one count for Oracle Code, one count for Java. And this is my first result. I get a result for all three of them. And there's the next result. Actually, this is not just one result. I see multiple results. I see DevOps UK at 2, at 3, at 4, at 5. It keeps adding. So I've defined a time window, and in this time window, say 5 minutes, some tweets arrive and they get counted and the result is produced. But then another one arrives. While we're still in that same window, it's also counted, it's added to the count, and it's also produced. So even within that time window, I get multiple results. The truth has just been updated. And that is one way at least of looking at it. And then the next time window starts and DevOps tumbles from 5 back to 1. Because in this next time window, we've had only 1. So that's correct. And it keeps going on like this. It's streaming, it's continuous. It takes some getting used to be honest. And the whole notion of the hopping window, I've been struggling with it for several weeks. Yesterday, I finally understood what it is. It's too much detail for here, but you will have to do some reading and some experimenting to really get a hang of it. So the flow we have now, and I didn't demo it, but doesn't add. So there's the tweet likes. Let's close the tweet likes. Let's look at the tweet count. And here we have the running count. DevOps UK at 245, and before too long it should be at 246, and it keeps on updating. And what is actually happening here? Well, the other ones are updating as well. What is happening here? There are tweets, and the tweets topic is read by a KSQL query. And this KSQL query takes the results, does the running aggregation, and publishes the outcomes from the running aggregation to the tweet count topic. The node application has registered to the tweet count topic as well and is sending the results to the clients with server sent event. But that part we've seen before. So the interesting new part is KSQL. This is the flow. KSQL, as I said, has multiple interfaces. There's the command line interface, which you use to start a query, which will create or create a table or a stream, which will create an underlying topic, and then the topic can be accessed in any way you can access a topic. There's also a JDBC driver, which is community developed, which is not exactly what you might think it could be. And then there's a REST API, and the REST API is both for manipulating the queries and the tables and the streams, but also for getting the results in a streaming HTTP fashion. So you get chunks of results pushed to the HTTP client, which could be quite interesting. Then underlying KSQL Server makes use of the Kafka Streams API, which you can also use yourself, but of course it's much easier to use KSQL because then you're writing KSQL queries. Underlying both of them, KSQL and Streams, make use of regular Kafka topics. In the end, it's all down to Kafka. And if you switch off the KSQL Server, everything will still exist in the Kafka cluster. So if you write a Java application, you have multiple options. You can go through the HTTP REST API, you can go through the JDBC driver, you can go directly to the Kafka Streams API, and you can go, of course, directly to the Kafka cluster and the topics. And then you can say there are three flavors of doing streaming analytics with Kafka. You can just go to the topics all the time and forget about the Streams API and forget about KSQL, or you can use the other ones that are more abstract, more productive, more fun, but may not always give you everything you need. And of course, they can be intermingled because in the end, they are decoupled at the level of the Kafka topics. The final step, the tweet likes and the streaming analysis of the tweet likes. We want to count the, and create a top three of the best liked tweets. So what we need to do is to take the like of the tweet and publish it as a Kafka event, which we didn't do before. We only pushed it back through the WebSocket to all the clients. So the node application will publish the tweet like the tweet likes on a topic. We get a second KSQL application or a second set of KSQL queries. They produce their result on a topic. The node application subscribes to the topic and pushes the result to the client. That again is not so very interesting. The WebSocket that receives the tweet like has one additional step to perform to produce the tweet like, and it will execute code like this. So this is server-side node application publishing an event, a tweet-like event, to a regular Kafka topic. And then it's available for KSQL to do its thing. This is the first step for that. And its thing could be something like this. Create a stream based on the topic and then start to do the KSQL things on that stream. And here we are creating a running count per tag filter of the tweet likes. And then there's a function in KSQL which is called top k, and in this case it's top three. Based on like count, we get the results. However, unfortunately, this did not work for me, and I'm in contact with the Confluent product manager who is using his internal engineering department to find out how this exactly works, should work, and does not work today. But I'm sure it will be fixed shortly. Given the time, I'm not going to demo it to you, but it is there. And I could, well, it's not pretty anyway, and you've seen the internals. Again, here's the flow. We start with a client-side event that's pushed through the WebSocket to the server. The server publishes an event out of it. KSQL processes the event, and the result of that processing gets on to a Kafka topic that's consumed by the node application that pushes it out to all the clients. Same flow. So this is the architecture of the entire solution that we have looked at. And we've only looked at a very ugly, straightforward, maybe straightforward is a better word, a very straightforward HTML user interface. But we could also have been talking about other consumers of those events and of the results of streaming analysis. Could be microservices, could be Siri, could be chatbot, could be a mobile application. And it's not just for tweets. It could be other sources of events, other use cases. Because tweets, of course, aren't maybe the beginning of it, but they aren't necessarily the end of it. And there are many other sources that we should consider, because the information we get from those sources is relevant to be analyzed in real time and to present the findings from in real time to our clients. So we're talking about fast data. There is so much more fast data than there used to be from all kinds of sources. And our users expect that data to be presented to them, the data itself and the findings from the data. And unless we convince them that we can make it available to them, they will keep using that F5 key. And that's what we don't want them to have to do, because it's not a good user experience and because it's bad for our backend systems. So we need decoupled processing. We want unentangled systems that work together but not hang together. And Kafka is one very important component that will help us resolve many of those issues and face the challenge. Because it's scalable, because it's distributed, it's reliable, and it keeps its history, but also because it's capable of doing streaming analysis in several ways with the Streams API and most recently through KSQL. And then we have a number of communication technologies, if you like, with browsers, but also with other HTTP clients, such as the server sent events, the WebSocket, and we're looking at HTTP2 to provide even more options. So our goal, and it should now be within reach, is an active UI that gives us happy users that are finally convinced to step away from their F5 key. Good luck. Thank you very much.